Boom. Hey.
And we're live.
Hey.
Live. Live. We're live.
Hump day.
We're live.
We're live.
We're live. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're live.
Yeah, we're live.
We're live.
We're alive.
We are live. We're here. We made it. We're alive. We're alive.
We're alive. Hey, guys. What's going on?
Hey, we're here. We're alive.
Happy hump day. Brandon Power, Joel, Amanda Putnam, Palmer, Brandon Power. What's going on, guys? Here we are.
Here we are. We're drawn to fantasy. There's things for us to see.
That's good.
When we are drawn to when we avoid reality.
Yes, let's get lyrics going.
Drawn, Tony draws. Ange comments. Yeah. More one more color study.
Molly Portridge!
Starring Molly Porridge with Brennan Power and David May. Kyle J. Patterson. Hey, guys. Hey, hey, hey.
What's
hey, now,
happening?
Hey. Hey, how you doing, Ange?
I'm crazy today. We have had
it's been a day.
Very busy morning.
It's been a day.
Wow.
What a day. It's good. And then we're not done yet. We're still going.
We
we're still chugging.
We're still going.
We're... We're having a good time. Molly Partridge wants to know if we made the creme brulee. You know, Molly, we came close.
Where is it? Where's your food?
It's I brought upstairs. I pounded
it.
She made bread pudding instead. So really, Molly Porridge, what I'm trying to say to you is COVID-19 is turning into COVID-20 for me, because that's about what I put on, because Ange just keeps baking so much amazing food. If you're just joining us, I am Tony DiTerlizzi, author and illustrator. I'm joined by my impressively talented wife, who's also funny and a good sport. You've had to put up with a lot of bad jokes for 20-something years. And I'm
27.
I'm sorry. I'm just 27 I'm going on record just saying I'm sorry right now to the whole world. That
I'm sorry. There's no need to be
you know,
sorry.
I feel like I torture you sometimes.
No, you don't. Well.
Yeah. See, sometimes. Sometimes I do. Anyway.
I love it. Every day is an adventure.
It really is.
With Tony DiTerlizzi and drawn to
fantasy. We're going
to
do a color study of our fairy. Here's the other ones from the last 2 days. That's yesterday's. That's the day before. We're going to do a third one, a crazy one. These are two. They're so similar, and they're not bad.
Red pudding.
They're called variations. I'm going to call that variations. So today we're going to do a crazy one, a third one. But we've got a lot of things to cover today.
Oh my gosh. So we started the morning
with
running. We hit the ground running this
morning. We did.
Morning.
We did.
So I started with waking up, getting cleaned up, and then hopping on SiriusXM for the Absolutely Mindy show.
How'd that go?
On Kids Place Live. It was awesome. I love Mindy. She is absolutely the best. We had a great time.
Well, she is absolutely Mindy.
She is absolutely Mindy.
Yeah.
And
she lives up to her name.
And she was so kind to have me on. I actually was supposed to be in Washington, D.C. today on book tour. And as I've mentioned before, and as all of you know, everything has been canceled, including my book tour. So I was not in D.C. as originally planned. So I got to hop on the air with her. And on a Zoom, and we talked about The Magical Yet, my new picture book.
Ange's new picture book it's not out today. Was its original release date?
Correct.
Is it now actually available?
So today was originally this The Magical Yet's book birthday, and it has been, I believe the shipping has been pushed back a week with everything going on.
Okay.
So it is, I'm not sure if it's available just for pre-order today or if you can actually purchase it, but I think it's available on the 21st now. But you can pre-order today if you grab it.
And I'm going to show it to our viewers here in just a minute. I'm going to put this base coat down of unbleached titanium. You guys should know the drill for those who have been tuning in day in and day out. But this is an unbleached titanium white that I'm putting down as a base coat.
So
why that dries, and you can see I'm putting it down very, very carefully. I'm staying right in the lines, Ange. as I always do.
Slapping the base.
I am slapping the paint. Slapping it all every which way. I'm just about done. I'm going to let that. And while that dries, I'm going to show off your beautiful book, illustrated by...
Oh, David May says he's going to receive his copy on the 23rd. So I think it is available. And it will be shipping on the 21st, which would be explaining why you're getting it on the 23rd. I'm going to do a thing where, and I'm going to upload the video. I was recording it, and for those of you who enjoyed the video of me getting dive-bombed by a wasp...
Hilarious.
Which is on my Facebook page, and also I think Emily shared it to the Drawn to Fantasy fan page.
Nice.
Emily, I was recording a video saying, if you buy a copy of the book and email me the receipt... which I'm going to make this more official in what I'm doing, but I'll send you a personalized video to thank you, basically.
Nice. Now, I don't want to show everything because you're going to read it later today.
Today at 5 p.m.
Today at 5 on Angie's Facebook page. She's going to read it. So I want to show you some of my favorite spreads. This, if you haven't figured it out, this book is about things you can't do today, but through diligence and hard work.
Patience.
And envisioning yourself succeeding, and with the help of this little yet, you can do things you couldn't do. Like before you could walk, you were crawling. And see, it all these things take time. It's all about time. It's really, in some ways, an echo of everything we've done here on Drawn to Fantasy, which is that nothing comes quickly or quite easily. It takes hard work. My favorite painting, though, and there is an artist in here, which is a great spread, but there is one about a boy who's a dancer, Ange. I remember, even at the book dummy stage, which for those of you who don't know, when you're laying out a picture book, you do kind of a sketchy version of the book, and that's called the book dummy, or what I like to call a rough copy of the book, and I'm the dummy who's made it. Anyway, here's a boy who's learning to dance, and he's doing all the moves, and he could see he's got his little yet next to him. Look at that. Look at that intense focus, Ange. I love that. If you keep leaping, dreaming, wishing, waiting, learning, trying, and missing... You ready for this? This is what they call like the page turn. Like it's so, I'm going to turn sideways just so they can get a sense of how epic this is. Boom. You see that? We went from a white background to this epic background. Like, come on, dude.
Serena Alvarez.
With the yet as your guide. Along the way, you do all the things you can't do today. That's this book in a nutshell.
I'll talk to you. I know somebody just asked what was the inspiration for this book. I'm going to share that and chat a little bit. I know you guys want to see some painting, so I'm going to let Tony dig into that. But today at 5 p.m., I'm going to be doing a Facebook Live on my page, and I'm going to be reading The Magical Yet, and I'll answer questions about it. So come hang out.
Come hang out with us at 5. I'll be there fielding questions for you if you need me to, Ange. Although you do it on your laptop, which makes it easy. So you kind of like lean forward and see the questions, which is handy dandy.
Yes.
That's... You go thinking again. So this is just about dry.
Mm-hmm. Lorena is amazing. I'm a huge fan.
Very talented.
My second favorite artist, Lorena Alvarez.
You're like my second favorite artist behind Mary Blair.
My second favorite.
Yeah. Somewhere in that top 20 on a sliding scale is Tony DiTerlizzi. Ange, if you guys didn't tune in yesterday, I did give away some of my deepest art secrets.
2 p.m.
Yep.
So 5 p.m. Eastern Time, 4 p.m. Central, 3 p.m. Mountain.
Wow.
And Cali.
You're doing a lot of math.
Dang.
I can't.
I'm just imagining myself physically flying across the country in the time zones.
You're doing.
What would I be doing right now on a plane?
If you were on book tour.
Yes, I'd be flying to Texas tonight.
And it's funny. I'm doing a little shadow. Guess what the shadow is, guys? It's Romber and Ash Blue making their third appearance this week. That was good math. And the reason I say that's good math is because...
That's good math.
That math is real good.
That's good math.
And it is unlike the math I am capable of. So
we did that.
We did what?
I did SiriusXM.
We did SiriusXM.
Then you hopped on a Zoom.
A Zoomer.
Well, I made bread pudding. Then we hopped on a Zoom to hear a pitch for a
potential thing that's being made out in Hollywood,
which was really good.
There's a lot of Hollywood things just have been slow cooking. I'm not kidding, for like 2 to 3 years, and they're all finally starting to come to a simmer, my friends.
Because everyone's watching TV and movies right now.
Yeah, so these are all multiple projects, and out of sheer, I think streaming has just opened up the possibilities for more shows and great programming, and the
you're really slapping it in there today.
The need of more material. Yeah, well, I'm in a good. Well, good. You after 3 days, you start to figure out. Yeah, you start to figure it out. I want to get to the good stuff.
So then you did, you just finished up, and then we ran over and came over here. We did Snack and Read Live with Simon & Schuster, with Simon Kids.
Yep.
And so if you are a fan of Kenny and the Dragon, you want to have a story read to you, head over to Simon Kids, and you can see Tony reading.
Doing horrible.
No, you actually loved it. It sounded so good.
Oh, good. Okay, but I think Molly Partridge is going to think otherwise, but... I tried my best at a British accent, for Graham, very stately, with a little bit of extra lip when he speaks.
No, he was very kind at the same
time. Yes, well, he also gets a little ruffled, and this, that, and the other thing. But anyway, that's my bad British accent. So, and I really did apologize. Oh, also, Molly, your package went out yesterday. I mailed a bunch of packages out yesterday that needed to be mailed and the required extra postage, including, by the way, Molly, I sat on your letter for a week with your prizes, which we now have a name for those prizes. We'll get to that in a minute.
You guys are...
You're not even going to believe.
Mind blown.
Our amazing daughter came through and came up with a name for the prizes. But so it sat on my flat files for a week with some other parcels that needed to go to the post office.
Parcels, you're so British.
Well, you know, I'm talking to Molly right now, Ange. I want to speak in her language so that she understands what I'm saying. And so I'm thinking, you know, I don't know this. I don't know how many stamps to put on this. It's just a letter with some bunch of stuff shoved in it. So I don't know if it's an extra stamp. I literally wait in line, which, you know, everyone's in masks and gloves and everything. So that's already, you know, and there's sneeze guards in front of the.
Harrowing.
It's just weird, right? Everything's just weird, as you know. Yeah, it's stressful, right? Nothing. Everyone.
Can we leave the bubble? Ugh. We're good. When we're here with you guys, we're
all good. When you leave and it's like Mad Max out there. It's
just, exactly. I want to wear one of those cool outfits.
It's contagion.
We don't need another hero.
Anyway, I'm like, okay, you know, I'm thinking this guy's going to be like, you know, that'll be $5. I swear to God, he pulls out like you're going to see it. It's like a circular stamp. He's like, it's like a dollar. He just takes like a circle stamp
I love that little circle
stamp. And he just puts it on. I'm like, wait, that's it? He goes, that's it. That's it. I'm like, oh my God, I waited. I'm sorry, Molly, but you know. You're going to get it and go, wait, why did it take so long to meet it for, you know, where all they did was put one stamp on it. I'm going to let that dry for a second. While that's drying, I'm going to talk a little bit about math. And I want to particularly point out something here. This is episode 25.
Is accurate.
That is, I think it's accurate. How do I know it's accurate? So I went back on all the videos on Facebook, Ange. And I realized they were kind of inconsistent in titling, and I just wanted to clean it up a little bit. We're getting more viewers. I want to make sure that it's easy for them to navigate if they want to look. Or actually what I'm thinking is if we refer to an older episode, you know, I'm actually referring to, right. I realized there's literally like 3 episode 17s. Like it was true Groundhog Day, and I just kept writing episode 17 over and over again. So I finally got them all numbered right and realized that we're actually up to episode 25. So we're almost to a month of watching me draw and paint live.
Hey, which, who runs Barter Town, T?
Who runs?
Master Blaster. It's from Mad Max. That's so good.
That's dang. Good. I forgot about that. Awesome. Well done.
Two go in.
One comes out. Raggedy Man or whatever.
My gosh. Tom Hofelder.
He's on. Of course he's on.
Maestro of music.
Yes, the musical maestro, the master impresario.
The musings.
The musings and muckety muck music and masterful mysticism and myth of magic of Tom Hofelder.
Oratory. No, what's just listening when you're hearing it? Music. It's another word for music.
I don't know.
Oratory stylings?
See that? That's a brown butterfly with a little bit hint of orange and a little hint of red and a little hint of a deep purple. This butterfly loves the band Deep Purple. I am not a big purple fan, but I am a fan of that kind of...
Periwinkle
blue. So I'm thinking browns with some browns and some creams and a little rust, not to mention a little bit of a wee bit of gray, but we swap the perp for the peri. What do you guys think? That's what I'm going to go for today.
Very nice sweat.
We'll see how Raggedy Man does it, if he can pull it off. And if I totally mess it up, it's okay. I've got more and more I can just keep printing. As a matter of fact, Ange, some people have been printing and doing... some of them are better. I mean, they're really...
There was like somebody's 11-year-old daughter, maybe?
Did a better job than I've been doing.
And let me tell you, they looked amazing. She was so good.
Yeah, so we're referring to the fans of fantasy. Am I saying the group right, Ange? Fans of Drawn to Fantasy? The fantastic fans of fantasy? There's some kind of...
What? Drawn to Fantasy.
But the
fans of Drawn to Fantasy.
The fantasy fans. Not to be too confused with the Fan Brothers. That's another episode.
Oh, talented artist.
Very talented artist indeed. No, Drawn to Fantasy, the group. You've seen the live stream. You've listened to the jokes and japes of Angela and Tony. Now join in on the Drawn to Fantasy Facebook group, where you can share your art and have it shared with other artists. I'm sorry, Soph's doing something upstairs.
I think it's the dog digging at the floor.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it was, because I just heard his little collar.
No, that's Mimi.
Yeah.
What is he doing digging? He's digging a hole down to this floor because
Oh my gosh.
Before the show started, he starts barking insanely just because.
Wait, yesterday was nuts, as you guys may or may not know.
Now he's trying to dig to this floor.
Pippin stole a bag filled with Hershey's Kisses and ate
the entire bag.
He left for each of us, the human family members. He left three of them. He ate about 20 of them. He did not get sick.
No.
Things were a little shiny when we took him out for a walk today.
They were shiny. Things are really...
Lots of
shiny.
But he was wired and off the wall for 24 hours straight. Crazy town.
He's literally...
Population Pippin.
If you've seen the animated adaptation of Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, there's a scene where the sheriff's son... has been eating all the giant-sized candy, and his eyes are doing that, like, Ka from the Jungle Book, where you know how Disney would always do, and their eyes would just
dilate
in rainbow colors? That's what Pippin was doing.
Oh, he was nuts.
All day yesterday. He was nuts. Do you want to check on him, Ange?
Nah. Soap's up there. I'm not worried.
Okay.
Yeah, that's awesome, David Howe said. We're called the Hidden Bowies.
Oh, my God. I forgot to post my photo of the Hidden Bowies. We'll have to get to that. We'll have to get to the Hidden Bowies later. I'll have to dig that photo up. It'll take a little digging, but it's there.
Alfonso Morales said, did you get my package?
Alfonso Morales sent us something.
Did it go to the P.O. box?
I checked the P.O. box yesterday when I went to mail Molly Porridge's package. So I'm not sure, Alfonso. No, but we did get another package from another fan from Eric Burkert, I think, and it's up in Sophia's room, though. I totally forgot to do it. We're going to show it off tomorrow, Eric, if you're listening.
Is it from Eric?
It was from Eric and his wife, yes. I believe.
Oh, yes!
Yes, it's up in Sophia's room.
That's so rad.
I don't know if he's listening, but yes, it's a testament.
Alfonso said, yes, it went to the P.O. box. We have not received it yet, but we did get some. But we'll keep our eyes peeled.
Well, let me look. I didn't get a package, Alfonso. I got a bunch of letters.
Oh, was it a letter?
I don't know. There's a bunch of letters here. No.
Tony got some fan mail.
No. And this one doesn't even go to me. This is for someone else. They put in the wrong thing. No.
Ooh, that's a bill. Send it.
Yeah, I got. Sorry, Alfonso. Nothing yet. I hope they're not Magic the Gathering cards. All right. So this is the raw umber.
Kim Zavsky wants to know. Kim Zavsky.
Who?
Kim Zavsky.
Okay.
Said there was a teaser about some sort of labyrinth story last time.
Sepia. Sorry, that's the color I'm using next. Oh, the labyrinth story. Yes. I think it's probably safe I can tell the story now. I'm like, nobody cares, right?
Which one?
The Henson labyrinth story with me?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't think. Like, who cares,
yeah,
right?
You yeah, you can tell that yeah, story. Sometimes this... things happen. Sometimes they don't.
Okay, so Liz, I'm going to preface this. And you guys probably know this. In La La Land, in Hollywood, everyone's kind of a little, you know, as an outsider looking in, you usually have to be kind of tight-lipped about projects as they're being developed.
Okay.
Right? You don't want to say too much for a couple of reasons. One, the project may never happen, and then everyone looks like a chump because they were like, yeah, we're going to do this. In fact...
Like, right now we have three projects
that could happen.
Could happen.
Could.
But, you know, I'm always the person that says, I believe it when I'm sitting in a darkened theater eating popcorn.
Yes.
That's when I'll believe it.
So, consequently...
Hello.
You don't talk about a lot of projects because either they never happened or they did happen, but it didn't happen with you. It happened with somebody else.
That's true.
So there's always that kind of like a weirdness with it. So, I can give you an example. Jimmy Zangwill, the movie, was in development for a couple of years, and it just – I never talked about it. There was a video clip that was mind-blowingly amazing, but I can't share it because I don't own it. Same thing with Spider and the Fly. There's some Spider and the Fly animation that was just unbelievable that was done years ago. And, you know, I don't talk about it much because there's really nothing much to say right now unless Spider and the Fly all of a sudden miraculously starts getting made into some kind of TV show or movie again. And then at that point, then the people working on it will say, don't talk about it until we make an announcement.
What, Jimmy Zangwill?
Well, any of those things. I'm just using those as examples.
And just as an example, not as an example, but most all of your projects have been optioned at some point.
Jeez, guys, almost everything of mine has been optioned at some point. We talked about Neil Gaiman yesterday. Neil actually gave me some really good advice about that because Neil has said the same thing, that almost everything he's ever done has been optioned. And he's like, listen, some are going to get made, some aren't. Some are going to get made and be really lousy, some won't. Some will be great. So he's like, you just keep optioning them and hope for the best. And he's right.
He said it's like trying to hold ether.
Sand in your hand. The tighter you grip, the more it slips through your fingers, Tarkin.
Just cash the checks.
Cash those option checks and keep going, my friend. I'm brushing a little... I'm putting a little sepia on. I'm going to zoom in on it so you guys can see that a little more instead of me yammering.
Share if you'd like that you're watching this stream. I know many of you have already. By the way, I know we had some people that haven't tuned in before or joined us before. Somebody asked me yesterday, how do I get entered to get your junk?
The garbage. The garbage, which we now have an official name for.
You guys.
Thanks to our daughter.
Yeah.
Thanks to our daughter. She came up with a name, because she came downstairs this morning eating her breakfast. I'm over by my where I do my mail, and I'm packing Andy Robinson's goodies up in an envelope to mail off. And I said, well, this is the thing that Mom and I do. You know, when we do the live thing, we give the stuff away. She goes, oh, you mean they hit the junk pot? I went, wait, what? She goes, that's the name of when you give it away. They hit the junk pot.
And I went,
so I'm going to make a graphic over the weekend, Ange, of a little leprechaun holding a recycling bin that shows someone, you just hit the junk pot. So it'll go something like this, like, and today Andy Robinson hit the junk pot. You know,
Andy Robinson, you hit the junk pot,
cha-ching, junk pot. So there you go. We have a name for it now. All right, all the way back to...
Oh, if you want to enter to win Junk Pot?
The Junk Pot.
share that you're watching this stream.
Just share it. It's just blatant creating more buzz for our thing.
Yeah,
that's all it is. More of us, the more the merrier. You may even see a paid ad. I put a couple bucks behind a Facebook ad. And really the reason I do it... and listen, I'm going to be... Again, we've always tried to be transparent on this. There's probably... close to 55,000 fans of my DiTerlizzi page, which is terrific. And I'm going to guess that less than a quarter of them even know I'm doing this. So that's really why we want to promote it and do that stuff. I just want to make it. There's a little box when you promote it that says, you know, who's this for? Is it for fans of your page and friends of the fans of the page, people who don't know who you are, people who know who you are but don't care. Like, there's all these weird boxes. And I'm just like, dude, I just want the 50,000 people who said, oh, I like his stuff, to actually know what we're doing. That's all.
Alfonso Morales says, instead of cha-ching, you need kerplop.
Or a crumpling paper sound would be good.
Hold on, I'm going to see if I can find any sound effects.
You look for sound effects.
I am. While I tell my, some out, guys.
And I'll tell my story. So, quite a few years ago.
Like on Howard Stern, they play little sound effects.
Yeah. Are you saying we're getting to Howard Stern level of broadcasting?
In my mind.
Yeah, sure. Okay, that's good. Yeah. I think that every day. So, I was contacted by the Henson Company. Now, I'm a huge Henson fan. I love the Hensons. I love what they do. They're hugely in, you know, I love the new Dark Crystal.
Wait, what is that? Oh, it's just a game show buzz. Your face.
You just don't want me to tell the story. I think that's all it is.
I thought it was...
You just, let me just, oh, what happens if I do this?
That was amazing.
Oh, look, here's an air horn. What happens if I hit this button?
Oh my gosh, you guys, that was amazing.
She got a look. Oh, because
it's coming out of the speakers.
Ooh, trombone. So that's all the story you're going to hear, because now we're going to turn to sound. Keep going. I got to hear some more sounds. Hold on, I gotta dry this. There. That's what's happening to me. That's like the soundtrack to my childhood.
Okay.
Hold on, it's super soaked. They're not gonna be able to hear anything while I got the dryer gone. I've been waiting. Yeah, it's so soaked. It's gonna get good. We're gonna keep going. We'll get to the color. Okay, a little better.
Okay, hold up. How about this one? Tell your story.
No, I'm good. Yeah.
Oh my gosh, this is...
Raw Sienna, what? He's going crazy today. He's picking all kinds of nutty colors.
Yeah, you are crazy. That's... But guess what? If you share that you're watching... You could win Junk Pot!
The junk... You just... Junk pot. Wow, that's good. Ooh.
Okay, I was excited. I forgot I had that album of sound effects.
No, you
like it?
Keep going. We got some good ones.
What kind of? Oh, I know. When you say something funny, we could get like,
What do we got? Hey, it's Tony DiTerlizzi, here with my co-host, the wonderfully talented DiTerlizzi. I just cut it. All right, today our first trivia question is, how many times did Tony do a color study of this Sprite? That's right, the Sprite that Tony painted way back in April of 2020 during the coronavirus quarantine. He did how many? Is the answer 12, 24, or 48? How many color studies did he do? Even he doesn't know. He stopped counting. It's like Groundhog Day. Ah, here comes Angela.
Okay, there we go. Just, I had to, it's so good.
It's okay, really good.
Go back to classical chill.
You sure?
I mean, I guess for now.
Hold on. I'm going to start telling the story and then go and do one more because okay, I know that's what you're going to do anyway.
No. Go ahead.
No, really, no. No. Yes, she's ready. So then the Hansons contact me, and before I know it, this is your life. Oh, no, you don't have any others. That was it.
I have so many.
I know, and I know you're going to unleash them. You're ready. You're just giggling and with your phone in your hand. Oh, man. Well, that's not all.
That's like when you get... Whoa, wrong answer?
Yeah. Or you got to blow your nose. Such a great sound. really is. They talk about music as the soundtrack of your lives. That wah-wah is the soundtrack of my life.
Okay. I haven't even been looking at everybody's comments because I've been too busy looking at sound effects.
No. Okay. We couldn't tell.
Okay, let me get back to our music here.
Do you guys like... Here's what's kind of crazy. You're doing that. I'm barely thinking. I'm just putting paint down just to kind of see what happens.
Okay. All right. There is music today. Here it is. We got distracted, you guys. You know what?
This happens.
We have this high energy morning.
Lot.
Doing radio, doing Zoom calls, doing Facebook Lives.
It's a lot. It's busy. Crazy
Let's
time.
Bring it down.
I'm going to bring it down to...
You're really going to town.
Really ruining it in a big way. I got to put the blue in. Once the blue goes in, this whole thing's going to light up. It's going to light up. You're going to be like, whoa, 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 Detro. I didn't know you had it in you. I promised you something different.
I thought we were going into blues.
Guess what? I'm building a bridge to blue. Yeah, I'm building a bridge to blue, Ange. I don't know if you knew that about me. But that's what I'm doing.
You're a bridge builder, babe.
Very fall, very autumnal. Very autumnal, Ange. And that's okay.
Oh my gosh. I'm excited. I just got confirmation. I'm going to do Simon & Schuster Snack and Read Live next week.
Well, your phone works. I mean, my phone didn't even work.
We did have technical difficulties.
We had a lot of technical. I couldn't get my phone to work. It didn't want to cooperate for whatever reason. It was in a mood. We even had the poor gal from Simon Schuster who does all their online stuff.
Emily Ritter.
Just trying to help walk us, trying to walk us through it. Still, what did the button do?
I actually said at one point, does this feel like teaching your parents how to use, like,
we're trying to use the Zoom and it won't Zoom on me.
How do you get the live? Where's the go live?
How the live? Live not working. Here we are. So it's coming along. I keep pushing the.
Okay.
These
Tell
autumnal.
Us what you're doing, T.
The autumnal colors. Well, I'm looking at. There's a butterfly.
Yes, Lorinda Chapin. Share the Sprite scan with your fourth graders, please.
Oh
do.
Yeah, I'd love to see what they come
share
up with.
Share it with all your students. Send us.
Let us know what you guys come up with. Love to see it. All right, I'm gonna put some of that blue in, Ange, because I know you're dying. Because right now it's looking like, you know, October in Fairyland here. But it's going to get interesting.
Okay.
At least in my mind.
Aww.
Before I blow your mind.
Carol Hagen, I'm going to credit you with inspiring me to draw more again.
Oh, well, I'm happy
to
hear.
Got my first two commissions ever in the last few weeks. Congratulations. That's awesome.
Oh, that's very cool. That's great. What kind of stuff do you draw?
Awesome, guys.
So what else you got, Ange?
Yeah, if you guys have questions, feel free. I've taken a break.
She got it out of her system.
Effects. I got it out of my system. And
it brought you so much joy.
Oh, are you kidding?
Yeah, well, that definitely brought you a lot of joy.
I love that. When I was a kid, this is a funny story. Tony, I don't even know if you know this.
I don't know, but I can't wait to get sound effects so I can interrupt you every 2 seconds with sound effects while you tell
us. I remember vividly being probably 6 years old, and my mom took me to the toy store.
Okay.
And at the time, there was some toy that was super popular, and it was like a little robot, like your own personal robot.
Not the Nintendo robot.
No, this would have been, I think, long before that. So it's probably early 80s, maybe 1980.
Okay.
And I'm at the toy store, a KB toy store at the mall.
KB, there's a word.
And we were getting,
that's a name I've not heard in a long time.
And we were getting a present for somebody for their birthday. And I was like, I really want to get the robot. And my mom's like, well, you can't get the robot. So she would not let me get the robot. She's like, well, you can get this. And at the register, she pulls out of the, like, you know, the last minute grab bag of stuff at the register.
Yeah,
shut your kid up.
The dollar stuff.
She gives me the slide whistle. Well, you can get this instead.
Oh, she's going to.
And I was like, I don't want the slide whistle. I want the robot. And she was like, well, you can't have the robot. You can have this. And I said, I don't want it. And she said, well, guess what? Then you get nothing.
Nothing.
So I left the store. I had a full meltdown, threw myself on the ground outside of KB Toy Store.
Wow.
KB Toy Store. And to this day, I regret not getting that slide whistle. I should have just got the slide whistle.
You could have tortured her. That's like one of the best SpongeBob episodes ever is the slide whistle episode.
I should have. But you should have. It was a battle of the wills, and I was like, if I'm not getting the robot, I'm getting nothing.
Here I've got a similar one where we had the way back when in 1970, we used to do in the 70s, 80s in Florida, you know, for the holidays, we would do a gift exchange, right? It would be, you know, everyone celebrated Christmas or some version of it, and so we would all the kids would get a Secret Santa and do it. So, you know, there was a price limit on what you could spend. So my dad or my mom, I don't remember who, took me to like the local, we had like a little, you know, like a dime store down the street from us called Goodner's Variety Store. Such a cool store. I loved it so much. It just had everything. You just could get like little model kits and yarn and it was just like an old timey, literally general dollar store. It was so cool. Anyway, we go in, and they had a spin rack of comic books, you know, and this is, you know, it's the late 70s, early 80s, so comic books are, you know, you can get anybody, Incredible Hulk, Batman, whatever, and Dad let me pick out, it was like a pack of like five.
Okay.
Because that was now within the price range of the gift, so it was like a whole pack of like Marvel comic books.
Right.
And I was like... I was like, oh man, I really want to get some. And Dad's like, no, you know, this is for your thing or whatever. Or my mom, whatever. This is for the, you know, for the, your gift exchange. So I go into my room with the bag. I very carefully cut the plastic bag open.
You did not.
I read every single one of the comic books.
No, you did not. And
put them all back in. Now in my mind, the person who received them was none the wiser. But in reality, I'm pretty sure the comic book covers probably looked like this when they opened it. They were like, oh, cool, thanks. You know, like, oh, look, it's brand new. I just...
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
By the way, I just went on Amazon and ordered myself a slide whistle.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, my God. Here it comes. I gotta hit this with the dryer. It's gotten a little murky and muddy, but I'm gonna bring it back.
What's going on?
You and me, the new shampoo. And your shoes are looking cool. Like I said, Ange, the secret of art is. Oh my God, slide whistle.
Come on.
You and that slide whistle.
It's going to be your new best friend.
No, it's going to be bad is when Sophia gets her hands on it. Then it's all bets are off. That kid is going to torch. You're going to rue the day you bought that slide whistle. Just like Squidward. All right, I'm going to try.
It's not an essential item, but still it said it's coming Friday. Apparently they think it's an essential item.
Well,
they know for me it is essential.
I need N65 masks, some rubber gloves, toilet paper. Oh, you got slide whistles?
Oh, yeah, you had a Henson story, by the way.
I did? I've forgotten it now. Mm-hmm. It's been blocked from memory. Yes, I do have a Henson story, which was, the short of it was, I was asked if I could come up.
Yeah, we'll use the slide whistle for the junk pot. When you did the junk pot, you did the slide whistle.
Are you just seeing how this is it? Do you see how this? It's like a running. She doesn't even know she's doing it. She doesn't even know she's doing it. She just thinks it's funny. Well, that's a show for today. Thank you guys for tuning in, and we'll see you tomorrow on Drawn to Fantasy.
Everybody's comments distract me because they're hilarious.
Tell me what some of the comments are.
Spenguli time.
Because clearly that's going to be more interesting than slide whistle.
Andy Robinson said get a jaw harp too. See, I told you. You're distracted by that.
A jaw. You just used the word jaw harp in a sentence.
Oh my gosh. And Susie Ashworth Tajik said, get a rubber chicken while you're at it.
Oh yeah, all the things.
Quarantine with a slide whistle could literally be the name of a practical joke show.
No, it could literally be the
your nightmare.
Yeah, the end, the beginning of the end is what I'm thinking.
The end times. Tony will have noise canceling headphones by Saturday. Mm-hmm. He's got them.
I've got those already.
Oh gosh.
All the flights.
Okay, so that's great because we needed a sound effect for the junk pot. So the slide whistle will be good for that.
The junk. Do you guys even like the junk pot? First of all, that's a question. Does junk pot? I mean, I thought it was hilarious, but I also think my kid's hilarious. But I'm probably a little biased.
Whoopi cushion.
But you don't need that. You have me right here. I can.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm not even gonna. It's done. No, it's done.
Do it.
It's done. It's done. It's done.
I'm not speaking right now. Go ahead.
For this minute.
Go.
No, it's done.
No,
it's done. It's not happening.
Everybody's waiting.
But are they really?
Yes.
No, they're waiting for you to find a new way to interrupt.
No, I'm not gonna interrupt.
This time.
They love junk pot.
Okay, good.
Now go.
I like this color pattern, but not for this fairy.
Agree.
I can already see it already. Like, it's getting closer and closer, but I don't think it's quite the jam for this fairy. I'm going to keep going, but I think my decision's already made.
Do you know what it is? It's so orchid-y, like you went super, but this is just almost too moth-like, too butterfly.
Well, I don't mind that. I'm going to put a little more blue in the brown. I want to just see something. I mean, this is the point, though, Ange. The point is, you're just messing around. You know what I mean? You're just kind of...
Dreaming on paper.
You are dreaming on paper.
Okay. Now, five people have said Henson's story, so I'm not going
to
interrupt.
Say it to Ange. Don't say it to me.
I just told you.
Okay, Henson's story.
Go.
I got asked... The highlight is I got asked to work on the sequel to Labyrinth. Just let that sit in your brain for a second, because that's how it felt to me when I was asked. And I had a call with the family and the folks who run the studio. We talked about a whole bunch of things, and they asked if I would be interested in writing the sequel to Labyrinth. And my reply immediately was, should there be a sequel to Labyrinth? I wasn't sure there should be a sequel to Labyrinth. And then I thought, okay, I'll entertain this. You know, maybe there's a sequel. Now, to give you an idea of how long ago this was, the next question out of my mouth was, is David Bowie interested in this? So he was still alive then. So that gives you an idea. And they were, they said no. So I was like, okay, so it can't be with Bowie. It's going to have to be a different thing. And I did, for a hot minute, kind of play it out a little bit. Like, we literally just spitballed, and I said, well, maybe we reverse the characters and it's Sarah who's, you know, it's Sarah's son who gets sucked in this time, and there's a goblin queen or something like that. And, you know, it's Lady Gaga or something like that. I don't know. You know, I'm just kind of literally just spitballing. But the short of the story was, they wanted me to make it as a book first, a very heavily illustrated book, which I misunderstood, thinking, oh, you want me to make a pitch book, which sometimes that's what you do for a movie, is you make a big fancy book that has a bunch of art in it and shows you, you know, kind of gives you a synopsis of what the movie is about, and then here's some bunch of pictures. So I understood that. But what they actually wanted me to do was just a book. And when I understood that, and I'm like, well, how does that come into the sequel of Labyrinth? And they're like, well, if the book does well, then we have the foundation for the sequel. And I said, okay, well, that I can understand that. That does make some sense. However, I want to just talk very quickly about the mechanics and the mathematics, since it's been the running theme for today's show, is math and counting things, which clearly I can't do. And I said, so if we made a book and 1 million people bought that book, that is so rare and so hard to do. To get 1 million people to buy a book is really, really tough. You enter a different echelon when you sell 1 million books. You sell 5 million books, you send 10 million books. You're hitting phenomenon level book sales. They just don't sell. That's why books like, everyone knows what The Diary of a Wimpy Kid is, because he has sold millions of books. So I said, if we sold 1 million books within a year or 2 years, the publishers would be popping the champagne. They'd be losing their mind. They'd be so happy. They'd be like, what's the next book about? This is amazing. But if all 1 million of those people went to your opening weekend, you'd make like, it'd be not a very good, it wouldn't be a strong opening weekend. It would be not a great opening weekend. So I was like, I don't know if you're putting too much pressure on a book. I don't think it can do it. And this ties into why my attitude when adapting, at least as far as my books are concerned, to film or other media, you have to let some of it go, because that story and the final product has to do something that's so different. The expectation level is so beyond what a book has to do for what a television show or a movie has to do. It's the stakes are much higher, so much more higher. You know, millions and millions of dollars higher. So, I mean, that's really it. I mean, to give you an example, the Spiderwick movie made money. It didn't lose money. It made money. It just didn't make enough money to warrant a sequel. It's an expensive movie to make. That one in particular was really expensive because they went through so many production ups and downs on it.
Well, and I also think movies changed, right? Like, it would be well, like, I think if something had a $100 million budget, it was insane. Now, Leonardo DiCaprio gets paid $100 million to make a movie.
Yeah, you know? Definitely. It was a big deal when Jim Carrey did the Lemony Snicket movie, and he got $20 million for that.
Yep.
And that was a big deal. Right? So it's just changed. Economics change. And it's interesting because with Netflix, no one actually, they're very secretive about their economics. So a lot of people don't know. I mean, we all know everyone's watching Tiger King because everyone's talking about it. And they greenlit so much Tiger King stuff, which tells me the numbers must be bonkers. But there's not a lot of that math that people can look at and point to. Now, there is a website called, that I refer to often, called Box Office Mojo, which is a great little resource, because what it shows is it gives an estimate of how much a movie probably costs to make. Sometimes it's verified, sometimes it's not. And then it will tell you how much it's made domestically and worldwide. So you can get a sense of what the mathematics are like on a movie. And it's just terrifying because generally it's diminishing, right, Ange? It's all about, when they say it's about opening weekend, it's really all about that opening weekend. And very rarely do the numbers go up the second weekend. They usually tend to go down.
Valerie Anderson said, I wish they would do a Spiderwick sequel.
Valerie Anderson, you never know.
Neither do we.
But if I do know for sure, you'll be among the first to know, because we'll be talking about it all day. The good thing is, thanks to shows, to the success of series like Game of Thrones, Breaking Bad, those are adult themed shows. Let me think of some for kids. Stranger Things. The Lemony Snicket reboot for Netflix.
Lock and Key,
another fine adaptation. There's been some really good adaptations made for TV that has sent a message to studios and film and TV producers that quality does matter. Actually, now more than ever, good storytelling matters because we have so many choices to pick from. And that's a great place to be. That means we're going to see some amazing, we're going to see so much good stuff in the coming years that we're not going to be able to see it all. That's my fear, is there's just going to be so many good things to choose from.
Here's the other thing. And actually, Molly Porridge just made a great point. It is cyclical. And it does come around. So what happens is, you know, things like we all grew up on
MacArthur,
E.T. and the Goonies and all of those Amblin movies. Well, all of those kids who watch those films are now adults who are working in the studios
and making,
feeling nostalgic, making movies and green lighting films, and also the kids who were inspired by those stories.
Yeah.
So it is in cycles, I think, that you often see, you know, the Harry Potter kids grew up and now it's Game of Thrones.
Definitely.
You know, so.
Well, yes. I definitely think too that, I agree. I mean, I think the Gen Xers, and that's Angie, that's your and I just generation, you know, longed for movies that felt like the movies we loved growing up, like the Amblin movies that Steven Spielberg made. And they figured that out on Stranger Things. They figured out how to deliver that. I'm just talking and painting now at this point. I promised you guys I would do a crazy diversion off the others, and I have done that. I don't know if it's better. It's just another version. I gotta let it dry, though. I've really soaked it in paint. Mm-hmm. We'll zoom out, though. It's got some cool things going on. I was looking at the Purple Emperor, which I'm infused with the Holly Blue. But I was looking at all these browns with these little touches of rusty orange and replaced the purple with this kind of periwinkle. Does it work? Yeah, but not as good as the others. You don't think it works at all?
No.
You don't like it?
That's just me. And again, you know, Tony and I have been together for 27 years, so we can be very open with one another.
I needed to see one that was completely way different than what I kept leaning towards. Just to show you, sometimes you do it. Now, again, we've stretched this process out over 3 days. This would be an afternoon for me. It would be 3 hours after lunch or 3 hours in the morning. I would have zipped through. I'm busy yammering, so it probably would have done it in like 2 hours. I would have painted 3 or 4 of these and figured out exactly what I wanted. But we've stretched it out over the course of a couple of days. And I probably wouldn't even have gotten this far and just went, no, this isn't the one. Chuck it. Go on to the next one. That's usually how it works. But, you know, we're all here together. We're hanging out. We're talking.
I also think that area, like, okay, so Tony mentioned earlier, he's a little, you can be a little colorblind, specifically with purples.
Yeah.
And that one on the right has a lot of purple in it.
Yeah, but I didn't put, that's what I just said. I replaced the purple with the periwinkle.
No, I agree, but.
It's in the wings too? Yeah.
And that's.
Yeah, but I.
That's okay.
Yeah, I replaced that with blue. I used the blue. I kept mixing the blue into the brown.
Yeah, but I think it went more to the brown.
Well, I knew that going in, but, you know, it's all good. Someone will hang it on their wall and go, look at this piece of garbage Tony sent me.
Exactly.
From someone's going to hit the junk pot.
Let me know if you guys shared the stream just so I can see who we're going to pick for the junk pot.
Who's going to win the junk pot? Yeah, we're getting close to it. The hour's already done. I can't believe it.
It's not that he doesn't like the purple, Alfonso.
I don't have anything against purple.
No. It's just, that's where he's checking.
I'm a little colorblind in purple going into blue, violet. And so usually I generally avoid it because I can't see exactly what I'm doing. I've been tested multiple times for it. And so I usually steer away. If you look through most of my art, you will not see a whole lot of purple. You may see a little of, if I use a real ruddy brown and I mix blue, obviously there's going to be some purple hue in it, but I can't see it that well. So I'm going to let this one dry. This is color study number 3. But I feel like the second one was the one, Ange. The one we did yesterday is the one I like the most. Color study 3. Ooh, this is a fine little flute. I feel like it's medieval times.
I'm looking at
names. Here we go.
Looking at names, names, darling, names.
I feel like of the three, I like yesterday's. Yep. Over day one. I feel like yesterday was the day.
Do you think that's the solution?
I do. I don't think this patterning, I feel like this is a little over the top. I would subdue it a little bit. Concentrate maybe a little less on the sleeve, a little more on the dress. You know,
I'm bringing in. I mean, there's so much cream. You could tint that to a little some kind of...
Well, I think for sure what I would do is I'd make these wings bluish, grayish wings just to break it up so there's not so much cream. I agree. So that you're just seeing the cream.
So much cream.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think this is the one I like. But we'll see. We'll let this one dry. See how it looks. That doesn't mean I won't use this palette on another fairy down the road.
Okay.
So we're coming up on the end of the hour, Ange. Do we have a winner for today's junk pot?
I have a winner today. Today's winner, please join me in congratulating.
Here it comes.
Now this is a special shout out.
Oh.
To Lorinda Chapin. Now, Lorinda Chapin.
Congratulations, Lorinda.
Mentioned earlier, you were a teacher.
Oh,
so
this nice.
This is a shout out for you because we want to support all of our teachers. Who are working so hard, teaching our kids from home. I know you mentioned your fourth graders. Thank you so much for all the work you're doing to continue to educate and engage with our kids from afar.
Yep.
We appreciate that. Thank you so much. And any of you guys who are teachers, congratulations. And congratulations, Lorinda.
Lorinda. And Ange is going to cue our outro music. But yep. Lorinda, once this is dry, I'll put it in an envelope and you will receive the junk pot from today. So how about that?
Guys, thank you for joining us today.
It was a good day. We talked about all kinds of stuff. It was a good one, though. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it as much as we did.
Hey, I'll be over on my Facebook Live.
That's right, 5 p.m. And then tomorrow, what we're going to do, we're going to transfer the drawing to Bristol Board so we can get ready to paint this sucker. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Stay safe and healthy. Be well.
Never abandon imagination.
Never abandon imagination. And thank you for being
drawn
to fantasy.
Teachers rock
with your host, Tony DiTerlizzi, joined by his lovely wife, Angela DiTerlizzi, with special guest, David May and Brennan Power. Teachers rock. So saith Graham the dragon. All right. There it is.
Thank you guys so much.
You guys are awesome. Be well. We'll see you tomorrow. Undrawn to fantasy. There's plenty for you to see. As we escape reality. Yeah, we really need lyrics. It'd be good. Yeah, we do need some
lyrics. This is where the
lyrics.
Side whistle would be perfect.
There it is. Bye!